don't tell anyone. But you're listening to The Best Kept Business Secret and his podcast, dedicated to helping you understand the successful business secrets that others don't want you to know, making no secret of success. Now, here's your host and quite possibly the best kept business secret anywhere, Mark Ford.
Hello again and welcome to your Best Kept Business Secret podcast with me, your host, Mark Ford, possibly your best kept business secret. Well, we've started the new year with brand new openings. Hope you really like that. But we're going to carry on doing the mini series of business lessons from the franchise that is Doctor Who. Today, we talk about the fifth Doctor, Peter Davison's era, and all those lessons of the beginning of the end. ...1981, the year I first became aware of the Toys R Us Christmas toy catalogue, the year I started following Wolverhampton Wanderers, the year I started watching cricket, the year a cricket-loving, flannel-wearing, ever-so-slightly-too-fast-talking and high-pitched blonde-haired chap took control of the TARDIS. This was Peter Davison's era. This was to be the beginning of the end. This is where it all started going very horribly wrong. After Tom Baker, the fourth Doctor in the BBC, had announced that he was leaving the role, the show's producers decided the next Doctor was to be played by somebody who presented something of a physical contrast to Baker, and by an actor who was already firmly established in the British public's mind. The actor was to be Peter Davison, who was chosen due to his critically acclaimed role as Tristan Farnan in the BBC series All Creatures Great and Small, which had current Doctor Who producer John Nathan Turner as its line producer. It was a choice that didn't wow the BBC nor fans alike, but there was a reason behind it, and we'll come to that later. The fifth Doctor's era was notable for a back-to-basics attitude in which silly humour, and to an extent the horror, was kept to a minimum, and more scientific accuracy was encouraged by the producer. It was at times a darker and grittier series, in part for seeing the death of one of his companions, Adric. It was also notable for the reintroduction of many of the Time Lord's enemies, such as the Master, Cybermen, Omega, the Black and White Guardians, the Silurians, and loads more. It was also noticeable for the genuine tag of wobbly sets and dodgy special effects. The fact that it did try to go back to basics, unfortunately, didn't help it. It made it worse. As a business lesson, there is something to be learned from going back to basics. It isn't always the saving grace it can be or could be. The idea behind the series was to entertain, educate and fill 25 minutes on a Saturday tea time. Looking back at it now, they went back to trying to tell stories on a 1960s budget, but in the 1980s and in the face of stiff competition from the glitzy and glamorous American TV series. They were always going to be second best and weren't even competing on a level of a budget version of a sci-fi series. It could be said that over the next 8 years, by trying to take itself so seriously, it made itself look like an utter joke. And for me, this period is exactly when it started happening. You see, when you go back to basics, there has to be a realisation that the world moves on and things change. Whilst there'll always be problems for business to solve, the way in which they solve them will change. It's like grated cheese. After many years of us making our fingers and knuckles bleed on cheese graters, the manufacturers of cheese and cheese graters now realise that we can buy pre-grated cheese in bags. Therefore, the market for cheese graters is not as big in certain places as it used to be. Does that make sense? So take this podcast, which will turn into a book, for example. You see, I've been sat here writing this and imagining a lovely paperback with a lovely cover and a lovely smell. But I also have to realise that some people like to consume their books via apps like Kindle. So book publishers going back to basics can't go back to what they did even 5 years ago because consumer choices have changed. And never assume that because a book is published, the writer is a multimillionaire. J.K. Rowling is definitely an exception. So Doctor Who, going back to basics, was a franchise trying to go back to the same basics of 1963. But nearly 18 years had passed, and we all know how quickly the UK had changed in that time. TV had changed, and the expectations had changed. Remember the onslaught of American imports. They were getting bigger and better, and they'd started moving away from sci-fi. 1980 gave us Buck Rogers in the 25th century. Battlestar Galactica had finished, but the US gave us Galactica 80 with Dick Van Dyke's son being awfully terrible. In 1982, they gave us Knight Rider, a talking, stunt-driving black Trans Am, and the Hoff. In 1983, they gave us the A-Team, with explosions, stunts, and no one ever being shot, despite the amounts of bullets. Buck Rogers in the 25th century had, however, removed one of the basics that underpinned the franchise. The controller of BBC One, Alan Hart, had decided to move the show to a spring transmission as opposed to its usual winter transmissions. He also decided to swap it to 2 episodes per week on a weeknight. This had the effect of halving the number of weeks the series was on air to 13 instead of 26, and moving from the autumn to a spring debut. This experiment in seeing the viability of running a twice-weekly drama serial would later lead to the launching of the very massively popular soap opera EastEnders in a similar slot. It also had the short-term effect of doubling the Doctor Who audience, which had dramatically dropped to 5 million in the last series, with the story Black Orchid being the final story of the regular run, and the only one of the 1980s to break the double-figure millions barrier for the story overall, with a recorded figure of over 10 million viewers. The last individual episode with over 10 million viewers was the first part of 1982's Time Flight. Now, the last two things that I've said seem to dispute my assertion that the show's producers were trying to go back to basics when they were obviously making changes to the show right at the very top. Well, you see, some of the management wanted to strip it back to basics. Some wanted to toy with it. And this would be a business lesson that would haunt the franchise for the next 8 years. You see, when things need to change, you need everyone, and I mean everyone, on the same page. Otherwise, some parts will work well and others won't work so well. All in all, it will leave a business that is not performing as it should, holding itself back, or be on a path to failure. Here at the very start of the tenure, with the producers doing lots of things, writers doing another, some actors doing something else, and the suits at the top experimenting with a show that had already seen a rapid decline. It's no different in business. See, one of the biggest rapid declines in a business in recent times has been the self-destruction of Toys R Us. See, how can a chain of toy stores collapse? How can toys ever go out of fashion? Simple. You allow this lot somewhere near the firm. Founded by Charles Lazarus in its modern iteration in June 1957, Toys R Us traced its origins to Lazarus's children's furniture store, which he started in 1948. He added toys to his offering and eventually shifted his focus. The company had been in the toy business for around about 65 years and operated over 800 stores in the United States and around 800 outside the US until its untimely demise early in 2018. Toys R Us expanded as a chain, becoming predominant in its niche field of toy retail, and also branched out into baby supplies and children's clothing. At its peak, Toys R Us was considered a classic example of a category killer. With the rise of mass merchants as well as online retailers such as Amazon, Toys R Us began to lose its share of the toy market. And this is what the press and media wanted to talk to you about and have you believe that the landscape had changed so much that it was forced to go out of business. Rubbish. Utter rubbish. It was, in my opinion, some massive mistakes that embodied such a lack of leadership that for a brand such as this to go belly up should be looked upon as almost criminal. Be very, very careful when you hear the line, "it's moved to online," being trotted out. You see, in 2018, for every £1 spent in retail, 84 pence was spent in bricks and mortar stores. And that's from the Office of National Statistics figures in December 2018. You see, it was at the start of the millennium that the board decided to switch things up, to improve the company. The board of directors installed John Ayler, formerly of FAO Schwartz, in May 2000. Ayler launched a very unsuccessful, expensive plan to remodel and relaunch the chain. Blaming market pressures, primarily competition from Walmart and Target, Toys R Us considered splitting its toy and baby business. The first issue here is that it's very, very, very easy, and I mean very easy, to blame others as to why you're not doing so well. See, it seems ridiculous now, as we look back on the tatters of a business that was a business with such a reputation and affinity with people's childhoods, that it just finds it easier to blame competition from pile-it-high, sell-it-low discounters. You see, if this were the case, all the mid-group and top-quality retailers would also be out of business. And it was because the strategy was wrong. Simple as. It gets worse. On March 17th, 2005, when a consortium from Bain Capital Partners LLC, Kohlberg, Kravis, Roberts, and Vornado, that should be so much easier to say, Vornado Realty Trust announced a $6.6 billion leverage buyout of the company. Public stock closed for the last time on July 21st, 2005 at $26.74, a 63% increase since when it was first announced that the company was put up for sale. Toys R Us became a privately owned entity after the buyout. Effectively, it was saddled with the $6 billion worth of debt and no genuine leadership team with vision, and this would become the straw that was to break the giraffe's back. On August 23rd, 2011, Toys R Us announced it would begin to open combined Toys R Us, Babies R Us stores, with 21 new stores using the concept, 11 of them having a full-size superstore format, and 23 remodeled into the concept. In December 2013, 8 days before Christmas, Toys R Us announced their stores in the United States would stay open for 87 hours straight. The flagship store of the retailer in Times Square was open for 24 hours a day from December 1st to December 24th to cater for tourists. The announcement came after snow and rain caused a nearly 9% year-over-year decline in the US store foot traffic. This move also pushed the retailer to hire an additional 45,000 seasonal workers to cater to the demand of the extended store hours. Since the toy business is incredibly seasonal, more than 40% of the company's sales come in during the fourth quarter of the year. It was a toy train that was beginning to run out of control and smacked of panic. In 2014, Toys R Us announced its TRU transformation strategy, which concentrated on efforts to fix foundational issues affecting future growth, including making stores less cluttered, improving the customer experience, clearer pricing strategies and promotions, and tighter integration of its retail and online business. In 2015, the company launched the first of a new concept store called the Toy Lab in Freehold, New Jersey. The new layout provided more space for interactive exhibits and areas to play with the new toys before purchase. That concept was then expanded to stores in California, Delaware, Florida, New York, and Pennsylvania. They were missing the boat. It was all too slow, too dated, and had no urgency. On September 18th, 2017, Toys R Us, Inc., filed for bankruptcy, stating the move would give it flexibility to deal with its $5 billion in long-term debt, borrow $2 billion so it could pay suppliers for the upcoming holiday season, and invest in improving current operations. The staggering thing was that the company had not made an annual profit since 2013. It reported a net loss of $164 million in the quarter end April 29th, 2017. It lost $126 million in the same period in the prior year. It was an utter shambles. And in early 2018, stores in the US and the UK closed its doors for the final time, and slowly across the rest of the world. The category killer was now dead. Had anybody gone shopping with Toys R Us in the last 10 years, they would simply tell you what the actual problems were. The management didn't change things fast enough, make out-of-town stores destination stores at a pace of a snail, and they would have been quite impressed with that. Its stores looked tired, cluttered, and poorly staffed. However, Toys R Us may have broke itself when it signed a 10-year contract to be the exclusive vendor of toys on Amazon in 2000. Amazon began to allow other toy vendors to sell on its site in spite of the deal, and Toys R Us sued Amazon to end the agreement in 2004. As a result, Toys R Us missed the opportunity to develop its own e-commerce presence early on. It went on to invest less than other vendors on their own online platform, and by the time they went bust, were seeming to get it right with over 40% of their sales being online. You see, as you can see, it's very difficult to get restructuring right, and I'm happy to admit that. Whether it's going back to basics or just trying to keep up, there is a common thread. It needs to be done with nimbleness. I can only imagine the amount of meetings and counter meetings and final meetings that big businesses need to go through just to move a dot, comma, or even cross a T. This is where small business has a huge, and I mean huge, advantage. If you wanted to do something today, change your service, change your website, change your branding, or stop selling something, you can do it within minutes or hours. You can move that quickly. Simple. So if you think something needs changing or you want to change something, well, change it. If you're waiting for permission, well, the only person you need to get permission from is yourself. So going back to the casting of Davison, some would say it was a masterstroke. Popularity had declined in Baker's last year because of various factors, including the actor himself, the stories, and its competition from flashy American imports. Every actor up until now had a solid body of work behind them, but none were flavour of the month or as busy as Davison was. On our screens, in All Creatures Great and Small, he was also in two other series called Sink or Swim or Holden Fort. It was smart to a point because the audience already knew him. Downside? Well, effectively, we got the character from All Creatures Great and Small in a cricket outfit flying around space in a blue box. So I'd suggest there's another lesson here. You see, if you're going to launch or market a product or service that's already out there, but with a different look, make sure it has a different feel to the substance also. As humans, we're very fickle beings, and we'll quickly get over the fact that something looks a bit different and realise that actually we could have saved a few quid by sticking with something else because it does nothing differently to the one we already have, or is that few quid cheaper? Look at the issues that mobile phone developers are currently going through. Aesthetically, well, that's very easy for me to say, aesthetically, they're all pretty much the same. The USPs are getting fewer and fewer. They're now just a bit quicker and lighter, and the cameras are almost as good as a professional camera. But once you get over that, actually there's nothing else really. So the hype fades very quickly. Davison himself had said that the serious discussion of how the character should be different from the other incarnations never actually happened. The most serious discussion he had with the producer, or the franchise leader, John Nathan Turner, was what the Doctor should wear. The Fifth Doctor's chosen mode of dress was a variation with an Edwardian cricketer's kit, and he was even seen to carry a cricket ball in one of his pockets, which actually saved his life in one adventure. He wore a cream-coloured frock coat, striped trousers, plimsoll shoes, and occasionally a pair of spectacles. He frequently wore an Optimo-style Panama hat and had a red band with black and white pattern, which he would roll up and place in his inside coat pocket. It was all a bit 80s and a bit there as we look back on it. And if you search the archives on YouTube, you'll actually find footage of an audience telling Davison how he should play this incarnation of Time Lord, or on a programme called Pebble Mill at One. Someone in the production office thought that this was a good idea. To be fair, it could be said that marketing and business gold can be mined from your public, but this certainly wasn't the case here, because perhaps people were being asked the wrong questions. You see, ask the wrong questions and you'll get the wrong answers. Ask the right questions and you'll get the right answers, just not necessarily what you want to hear. Now, one of the things that hampered the start of this tenure and never really went away was a problem in the production office. Nathan Turner was not on the BBC books as a producer, even though he had been fulfilling the role for over 12 months. The head of serials at the BBC, Graham MacDonald, was asked by the top brass to become head of series, which then meant he had twice as many programmes to deal with and no more resources. Although MacDonald had given Nathan Turner the role, he was not entirely convinced that he could cope, and so asked Barry Letts, a show veteran, to step in and effectively do a lead executive producer role on the show. Now let's put it this way, it was like chalk and cheese. JNT was a flamboyant extrovert, and Letts was the kind of bloke that would sit in the corner and think about things. Their opinions on how the show should be run were quite simply not on the same wavelength from the start. Now, this just doesn't work when it comes to business, putting somebody into a role who has little or no connection with those already in similar roles. You see, I've had it myself. Managers and directors that have come in and above me and want to change things because it's not what they would do. In a minimal amount of cases, you'll find that the experience they do have actually helps you in your role. However, in a majority of situations, you'll find that if there is little or no connection with the people they are there to manage, it's like pushing wet spaghetti in an uphill competition. It's just not going to work. See, someone somewhere is going to feel isolated and therefore work less effectively and efficiently. So at least wanting the same goals and having the same visions on how to get there are key to that type of relationship working. The problem manifested itself in the form of disagreements on scripts. Letts would see things not making much sense or not how they would have previously done it on the show. And instead of J&T taking time to talk about it, he would brush Letts off and ask him to talk to the script editor. This meant that script editor would often work late into the night and even be locked in by the cleaning staff because he was changing so many things. Eventually, he moved on. The first part of collateral damage. Anthony Root then joined the team as script editor and in his first meeting with J&T had a pile of scripts and treatments deposited on his desk and was told which one was to be worked on first. At this point, J&T told him he was off to America for a convention and he'd be back in a week. Now remember, this was before emails and mobile phones. In a parting shot, J&T said that if he really had to speak to Letts, then speak to him. The script that J&T had wanted him to work on and to be the opening episode for The New Doctor was, in Root's own words, somewhere short of being able to be produced. This rookie was being asked to salvage something from a potential train wreck. He should never have been put in that position. He went to see Letts, and Letts agreed. Between them, they found a script that was almost ready to be done and finalised it. Told the director and the production team about what was to be done first, and they just got on with it. When J&T came back, there was a showdown. J&T had shirked responsibility, and this goes further to prove what can happen when members of management have different views on how or what things need to be done. People just shirk responsibility. The series opener was hurriedly rewritten and changed in less than 1 week. And Root, well, he left within a year. So further to what I've already spoken about, this goes to show what can happen to a team that has expectations and goals set by two different styles of management. It gets pulled apart and good people leave to do other things because they just don't want the added stresses, strains or hassles. If only senior managers were told what really happens when people don't get along, because one day they do find out. By getting low or no results, poor standards, they find a blame culture and poor morale amongst those that are left standing. And this is what was happening to the franchise. Now, somehow, J&T was promoted to producer full time, and Letts agreed to step down after a year so that J&T could be sole producer of the show. Personally, I think this shows a huge amount of professional conduct by Letts, as whatever you read or see, you'll not find him being disparaging about what happened. Letts went on to do some other fabulous things on the BBC, and Doctor Who was now the sole property of J&T. Problems with scripts and quality of scripts continued. One of the going back to basics had also caused yet another problem. You see, the TARDIS crew had now grown to four, the Doctor and three companions. Admittedly, this was not a problem with Hartnell's era, because as his health faded, writers were able to give the companions more to do, and even some episodes had no Doctor in them whatsoever. But trying to give three companions enough to do and follow the Doctor was at best clunky. So a decision was made, and it shocked Whovians all over the world. They killed off a companion. Adric, played by Matthew Waterhouse, was a boy maths genius, and unfortunately, not the most likeable of characters. He met his death in a story called Earthshock that had seen the much heralded return of the Cybermen, so it created a massive shockwave in the viewers when the companion heroically died trying to save the human race. The series also ended with another cliffhanger as to whether one of the other companions, Tegan, had left the TARDIS. Now, despite the challenges that were going on behind the camera, the series, in its new time slot, with its new lead actor, was classed as a success. But how long would things behind the scenes stay behind the scenes? We touched on going back to basics and going back to the past. Now, you can only do it for so long. Because of the praise and the adulation from fans over the story with the returning Cybermen Earthshock, JNT wanted more from the past. In fact, there were returning monsters and villains in every episode of Davison's second series. Behind the scenes, tensions were growing, and now there were tensions between its main actor and the producer. And this started boiling down to how the show was being marketed. I've already said that JNT was certainly the more flamboyant and extrovert of the producers, and he worked, without doubt, at the beginning of his tenure to make Doctor Who as marketable as possible. He would work exceptionally hard to get the show into the press. Remember, there was no social media, as this would definitely have an effect on ratings. He began to cast stars into roles that would grab some media attention. Davison felt this was to the detriment of the show, and in some cases, the people that were cast weren't suitable for those roles, and when other talented actors could have played the part much better. It was the beginning of the stunt casting. Something that would lead to much derision. The stars were mainly from the worlds of comedy and light entertainment, with JNT himself saying numerous times that there is very little difference between a comedy actor and a straight actor. It's just that short-sighted people tend to pigeonhole them as comedy actors or light entertainment stars. He wanted to make the show larger than life and bigger in America. Admirable, if not foolhardy at the time. Remember that the show had already taken a hell of a beating and a battering from the imports on other channels. Publicity and marketing, he thought, were his forte. So if he could generate interest by any means, he would do so. As some of the cast members have said, if an actor in the show could get up on stage and do something, well, that would benefit the show. With many having done cabaret-style performances in the US at conventions and promotional tours. His weakness was getting to grips with the drama and the sci-fi aspect of the show, the core part of the show. His passion was variety and pantomime, so much so that Davison was roped into doing a pantomime in Tunbridge Wells that was also produced by JNT. You see, Davison recounts that at the time there was very little rehearsal of Doctor Who, but more emphasis put on the pantomime. Stunt casting, storylines not thought through, laughable effects even for its time, and some poor acting meant that the significance of the show began to fall away quickly. A massive lesson here is not to let the quality of what you produce wane in the pursuit of other things. As Nyssa, one of the other companions, left the show, a new companion was brought in, Turlo, whose primary purpose was to kill the Doctor. Well, you see, now that may have been a good idea for a few episodes, and probably after a bottle of wine, but for a whole series? Awful. Just awful. Script writing descended into chaos. The show was becoming patchy. Under previous production teams, the scripts had been more of a collaborative approach to writing. Under this team, someone who had a passion for the show shone. Others looked like they had been writing stuff in between jobs and lacked passion and any energy. The team approached writers to write for the show. If they were well known and the storyline was good, they would commission a script straight away. If they were inexperienced, they would ask for a scene breakdown. If that was liked, they would then commission the script. In Eric Saywood's own words, there was never much planning when it came to scripts. JNT was resistant at old writers coming back, calling the legendary Robert Holmes an old fart. It became apparent he knew very little about the scripting process, which was staggering given his number of years in the industry, yet he still wanted to keep full control of the whole process. Davison, its lead actor, grew isolated as he didn't want to take sides, and the writers, who essentially were in charge of the fictitious world in which the franchise inhabited, were pushed well down the pecking order of importance when it came to decision making. What was forgotten is that without any good stories, there would be nothing to show. Without anything to show, there wouldn't be anything to market. It could be said that the show succeeded despite the management's best efforts. The cast and some of the production staff had gone on record also citing that the directors used for the show, and I guess in terms of this piece of work, the people managers, weren't the best either. Many of them had just completed the director's course, or they were old directors that were just very experienced and just biding their time until a better job came along. They would then fall into two categories: the directors who did direct and those that didn't direct you. Perhaps they could have come up with a better word than director. But the same things happen in management: those that manage you and those that, well, just don't, until it all goes tits up. They are really what's known as facilitators. They get you into the right place, doing the right sorts of things to a point, but don't help you get better or make the most of what you and the business has. It had become a workman-like program at best, and the directors were being asked to do a workman-like job. Some would say, based on its budget, they did well, but it really did show when somebody with a genuine passion came along and got every drop of drama or sci-fi out of an episode. You can't make a silk purse out of a sow's ear, but you could at least make a practical bag. Things came to a head when head writer Eric Saywood had a dispute with producer J&T about losing a very talented director. Saywood, understanding that good directors were very hard to come by, was appalled and dismayed when he realised that this one particular director had been dropped from the director's roster. J&T was now becoming a strutting peacock and would start an argument in an empty room. He had vast enthusiasm, and this was his virtue, but he was masking his deficiencies. He was upsetting everyone and anyone, but would still get the show to screen. He was in danger, and some would say that he ended up doing it anyway, of thinking he was bigger than the show he produced. Something that had been already levelled at two of the actors in previous years. Davison had become frustrated at the way the show was being run, the standard of writing, and now the standards of directors for the shows. The viewers were also becoming frustrated. Viewing figures were beginning to slide, and although they had not been treated entirely fairly with scheduling of this season, audiences started to feel there was something missing despite all the crowd-pleasing that was being attempted through casting and old foes. Add to this the beginnings of the new channel, Channel 4, and the rise of the home video recorder, maintaining viewing figures was getting harder than ever. It needed to change. Again. There was some brief respite and salvation on the way. A 20th anniversary of the show was on its way, and the stakes were high. Five doctors, countless companions, and even more aliens, and this was due to be a celebration of the highest order. But this threw up more bumps than was really needed. Despite his own rule of not going back to old writers, Robert Holmes was asked to write a script. However, he found the shopping list of what was allowed and what wasn't allowed creatively stifling. So it fell to another old fart in the form of Terence Dix to pull a script together. Another bump came in the form of Tom Baker not wishing to reprise his role so soon after giving up his tenure and trying to move away from the typecasting he was experiencing. The next was the recasting of the First Doctor, with Richard Herndl taking up the role which had been played by William Hartnell. Some loved it, some hated it. I fell into the latter camp, if I'm honest, and much prefer the 50th anniversary episode, which I'll talk about later at some point. The show did draw some media attention to the viewing public, and the franchise was still there. I guess for its time, it probably wasn't as bad as we think it is now. But having grown so unhappy with what had happened over the last 12 months, Davison informed J&T that his next series would be his last, having been offered an option to go for a fourth series. Now, although much truth there is in what I've just said is a bit debatable, You see, Patrick Troughton, the second Doctor, is often lauded as the man that told Davison to go, suggesting that any more than three series would mean he ran the danger of being typecast. Davison says it was because of his experience of the second series that he based his decision. Alongside the special, BBC Enterprises chose to do their own version of Doctor Who Woodstock, which gave them an insight in how popular the show could be, and embarrassingly, how it should have been. There was an official two-day convention held at Longleat House in Wiltshire. There were all four living Doctors there, including Tom Baker, as well as sets, monsters, props, makeup, panels and merchandise. Now, I said embarrassingly earlier, as BBC Enterprises, despite JNT's protestations, something that he did get right, only expected a few thousand to visit. Over 40,000 people visited in a two-day period, long before such things as Comic-Con and TV and movie shows. Many left disappointed. But although Davison wasn't seen to be as big a personality as at least a couple of his predecessors, he spent all of his scant free time walking up and down the very long queues, signing autographs and shaking hands with fans of the show. These mistakes, when it came to publicity and merchandising, would not happen under the new series running at present. See, I guess the lessons to be learnt from here is to not underestimate what your public really wants and what they're prepared to pay for. The surprise came here from people who hadn't pre-booked tickets, and in a world which we live in nowadays, I doubt this would happen again. I can't imagine Wembley allowing anybody just to turn up. But with the right amount of promotion and marketing, a business needs to be able to manage its customers' expectations. If you have a limited space or quantity of something, then manage that expectation, both for the public and for yourself. There is always going to be some disappointment somewhere, but learn from those mistakes and make incremental changes. You see, retailers, historically, are pretty crap at this in general. They have something on sale at X amount, and because they've sold 100 units in a day, order 1,000 units, only to have 950 sat on the shelf for the rest of the year. I saw this with a firm that imports Halal Cola and Orange Aid. They sold a bucket load to retailers and shopkeepers up and down the country, and because they sold an entire container in less than a month, they ordered more. A lot more. I walked in when they still had four containers left from four containers ordered 6 months after their initial selling spree. The product was good, and in a blind taste test, you'd struggle to put it below premium well-known products. But it just didn't sell in stores. There was little or no brand awareness, and it just sat on people's shelves waiting to be discounted. You see, you should wait for feedback on whether something is a hit or not. Do research. Being oversubscribed is not a bad thing and can be a cause for celebration and maybe price increases. It may also be down to the fact that you've misread the marketplace. On the flip side, just because you sold a quantity of a product or a service in one hit may not mean the market is as big as you think it is when it comes to doing it a second time. Now, the scripts deliberately tried to go darker for the last series to recapture its hemorrhaging viewership, but some of the special effects were now laughable at best. In one story, there was a monster that was so rubber and slow, you can actually see the cast smirking at the threat that was being posed. They tried to recapture some form in all that chaos with the Master and the Daleks returning. Some fans thought it had gone back to Davison's first series levels, but the decision had already been made. In fact, three decisions had been made. Mark Strickland, Turlough and Janet Fielding Teagan had also decided to leave. It was a full character changing of the guard. Fielding reportedly hated the whole thing so much he actually gave up acting. Wow! And in a break from recent tradition, JNT decided to regenerate the Doctor in the season's penultimate story to introduce the sixth Doctor to audiences before the seasonal break. Davison's last regular appearance as the fifth Doctor was in the last episode of The Caves of Androzani by old fart Robert Holmes, broadcast on the 16th of March 1984. Davison returned to the role briefly in 1993 in an awful charity special, Dimensions in Time. Then, beginning in 1999, he recorded a series of Doctor Who radio dramas for Big Finish Productions. And in 2007, at the age of 56, appeared alongside the 10th Doctor, David Tennant, in a Doctor Who special for Children in Need, written by then-showrunner Stephen Moffat, and titled Time Crash. This was the first official time that a Doctor from the new series had met a Doctor from the original 26-year run. He was, and should have been, my Doctor. He did something that many thought difficult. He slipped into the space left by Tom Baker. He captured new hearts and new minds of children who had grown up to love Doctor Who. Most importantly, he helped mould the hearts and minds of the writers and showrunners that run the franchise right now. Not a bad legacy when chaos was reigning all around him. But for now, the seeds of things to come had been planted. And believe me, we're in for a bumpy ride. So, here are the things that we've learnt from the Fifth Doctor's time. Number one, going back to the past is only where some of the answers are. It fixes certain things for certain people. You'll see life and business evolve. Different generations want different things and do different things different ways. The baby boomers want different things to the millennials. Yet we all operate in the same marketplace, and your goods or services could be as useful to me or my 16-year-old son. Take the good of the past and lace it into the new. That means it has connection and relevance. Number two, experiment with new things, but not to the detriment of the original product. In this scenario, there was too much experimentation. Storylines, days and times when the episodes were being shown, etc. It affected the show going forward, and more of that to come. But if you take a look at the failure of New Flavour Coke, which was launched in April 1985, experimenting can have devastating effects on your business. Launched as a replacement for the original flavouring, it was pulled from the shelves quickly when sales fell off a cliff. People just didn't enjoy it, and it was too far removed from what people had been used to. Right now, they seem to have got it right. You see, you can have original tasting Coke, but you can also have peach, mango, vanilla, cherry, sugar-free, caffeine-free, etc., etc. But it's the customer's choice as to what they have. Just replacing a well-known option with something relatively untried, and yes, I'm sure they did do taste tests, but it's not true of a representation of millions of bottles and cans sold throughout that world. It could be a suicidal business decision. Number three, get everyone on the same page when changes happen. I've described the rise and fall of Toys R Us in this chapter, and part of its failure was not to be quick and nimble as it could or should have been. As a small business, you can change as quickly as you want or need. Don't be afraid of it. It's a strength. Ask people's opinions, preferably those of your customers and of people that you respect, and implement what you need to do at a pace. It could be the difference between going backwards or moving onwards and upwards. Number four. If you're going to employ someone to put someone in place to work with a team, make sure there is a connection between them. In businesses, opposites very rarely attract. They usually lead to low deliverables, failure and infighting. And usually by the time you've realised it, it's too late. People must be on the same page with the same vision and the same goals, added to that with similar working methods and values. Otherwise, you may need to make a decision about the people already in place. Are they right for what you want in your business? You cannot run a business by democracy. A leader needs to emerge and be followed. Number five, is the line of management or decision makers within your business the right one? Taking this period of the franchise history, it could be argued that the writers were pushed far too far down the production structure. The writers are, as showrunner Stephen Moffat has said, are in charge of the fictitious world in which this franchise inhabits. So do the right people have the right amount of say in your business and help you understand its direction? Number six, substance over image. Getting in something or someone to promote a service or product is fine, providing it gives the value that's being tantalised. With this doctor, we ended up getting an out-of-breath, floppy-haired vet in space. A shame, as the writing, effects and casting did nothing to back up the promise of a new young doctor. Always do things with value and the customer in mind. It's not all about you. There's a bigger picture that always needs to be addressed. And finally, number 7. Manage people's expectations and manage your own at the same time. Wait for feedback. Wait to see whether there is an appetite for what you want to offer at the price you want to offer it. Don't screw something that works well when you can experiment with things by adding value to original products or services. Ask the right questions and look for the uncomfortable answers. And that's it for this podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. We're at Doctor 6. Colin Baker is the next doctor. And oh my God, there are so many lessons on how not to do something by top management, by lower management. Do you know what? When I said at the beginning that this was the beginning of the end, unfortunately it was. All the seeds had been planted and they came to fruition over the next few years, including one of the worst bits of merchandise you are ever going to come across from anywhere ever, I am telling you right now. Guys, if you'd like to get in touch, please do so. Go to my website, which is www.markford.uk. That's www.markford.uk. Go to the contact page. Let me know your thoughts. Let me know what you're thinking. Let me know if you'd like me to cover anything in future podcasts. More than happy to do that. More than happy to talk about things that you want covered. Go and have a look at the events. Go and have a look at my books. Go and have a look at some downloads, some videos and all that sort of stuff. There'll be more videos coming online in the next couple of weeks. So quite excited about that. Until next time, love you lots. Go out. Be brilliant. Make this year your year. And I will see you very soon.
Shh. Don't tell anyone, but you're listening to the Best Kept Business Secret and his podcast, dedicated to helping you understand the successful business secrets that others don't want you to know, making no secret of success.